This video is the first of two that go with Section 57 of Hansen and Quinn's Greek An Intensive Course, and it covers the middle voice in all tenses of the indicative. You can refer to Hansen and Quinn pages 163 to 169 for their coverage of the material in this video, which they revisit in the appendix on pages 743 and 745. When you first learned about Greek verbs, way back in Unit 2, we talked about how we look at five things in a verb form: tense, mood, voice, person, and number. As a review again, Greek regularly uses six different tenses: present, imperfect, future, aorist, perfect, and pluperfect. Now you've met all of those tenses in the indicative mood, and you've learned the present and aorist of the subjunctive and the optative. And we're going to save the imperative mood for Unit 11. You've learned present, aorist, and perfect infinitives, and we'll also get participles in Unit 8. Of the three voices in Greek, active, middle, and passive, you've learned everything in the active voice, and in which the subject of the verb is doing the action of the verb, and in the passive voice, in which the subject of the verb receives the action of the verb. You also know first, second, and third person now, and singular and plural number, and also dual, that we don't use very much. Now we're going to learn all of those things, all of those persons and numbers and tenses and moods, in the middle voice. So, what then is the middle voice? Let's talk about it in English first. Remember our example of the active voice. Helen hits Leo. The subject is Helen. The verb is hits. The direct object is Leo. This is in the active voice because the grammatical subject of the sentence, Helen, is doing the action of the verb hits. Remember, when we turn it around, Leo is hit. Leo now is the grammatical subject, and the verb is both words is hit, and there is no direct object, since the passive voice can't have one. Because the grammatical subject of the sentence, instead of the direct object, receives the action of the verb. That's the job of a direct object in an active sentence. You also remember that you can specify who does the action in a passive sentence. In English, we would say, Leo is hit by Helen. In Greek, we'll use the genitive or dative of agent. Now, English doesn't have a middle voice, but it does express things that Greek uses the middle voice to express. For instance, Helen causes Leo to be hit. Helen is the subject, causes to be hit is the verb, and Leo is the direct object. Helen is the grammatical subject and making the action happen, but indirectly. Leo is still receiving the blow, and so he's back to being the direct object. Another thing that the middle voice in Greek often does is to express an action in which the subject has a special or selfish interest. Perhaps Helen hits Leo for herself. Most often, though, verbs have a particular meaning in the middle voice that you will learn as a part of your vocabulary. The list on page 168 gives you a start of those definitions with the verbs you already know. In fact, luo is a great example. In the middle voice, luo means ransom, because when you send money to free someone, you cause them to be freed, even if you don't untie them yourself. You prompt the action. Not all middle meanings will be quite so logical, and many of them will simply be the intransitive version of a verb. Before we learn our new endings, let's have a refresher on principal parts and what they do. Here are the six principal parts of luo, which I like to designate, as you know, with Roman numerals. We've learned to go to specific principal parts when you have certain tenses. The first principal part is for the present and imperfect. The second is for the future. The third is for the aorist. The fourth is for the perfect and pluperfect. The fifth is for the perfect and pluperfect. And the sixth is for the aorist and the future. You also know that we get all the active forms from the first four principal parts, and all the passive ones come from principal parts 1 and 5 and 6. The middle voice comes from the first principal part for the present and the imperfect, the second principal part for the future, the third principal part for the aorist, and the fifth principal part for the perfect and pluperfect. The good news is that the middle forms from the first principal part are identical with the passive forms of the present and imperfect, and the middle forms from the fifth principal part are identical with the passive of the perfect and pluperfect. So, to form the present indicative middle, you remember the present indicative passive, and you know those forms already. First principal part, primary middle passive person markers, because now we have to call them middle and passive person markers, recessive accent, and the default translation in the middle is she verbs for herself, or she causes to be verbed if you're doing simple aspect, or to stress the progressive repeated aspect, she is verbing for herself, or she is causing to be verbed. Again, present tense can do present time and simple aspect, or present time and progressive repeated aspect. To tell the difference between a middle verb and a passive verb, you'll have to look at the context. The biggest hint is if there's a direct object, because then it has to be the middle voice, because as you know, the passive voice can't have a direct object. So, let's move on to the imperfect indicative middle and its forms, which look exactly the same as the imperfect indicative passive. So, this will be, just as you learned before, first principal part plus the past indicative augment and the secondary middle passive person markers, and the accent is recessive. The default translation in the middle is she was verbing for herself, or she was causing to be verbed, because we are in past time with progressive repeated aspect. Okay. The future indicative middle will, alas, not be the same as the passive. We're going to use principal part 2 and not principal part 6 to add endings to. So, here's our stem, and we'll need a place for endings. So, let's look at all of our middle, passive, primary, and secondary person markers. And we're going to want the primary, because future is a primary tense. So, here are your endings. Omai, a or a, etai, omitha, estha, and ontai. In fact, as you can see, these are the same endings exactly as the present indicative middle or the present indicative passive. Yay! Accent is recessive. And the default translation is either she will verb for herself or she will cause to be verbed for future time simple aspect, or she will be verbing for herself, or perhaps she will be causing to be verbed if you want to stress that progressive repeated aspect. Let's see, since this is a new paradigm, what the full forms of the future indicative middle look like. So, we need the second principal part stem, and then we need the endings, which look like that, recessive accent, and let's put those in, and we get lusomai, I will cause to be freed, or I will ransom, luse, you will cause to be freed. Remember that you can use the alternative form luce, just spelled differently. And also, of course, the future meaning is probably more like you will ransom. Lusitai, she will cause to be freed, or she will ransom. Lusomatha, we will cause to be freed, we will ransom. Lusistha, y'all will cause to be freed, y'all will ransom. And lusontai, they will cause to be freed, or they will ransom. Let's move on to the aorist indicative middle. We're going to be going back to the third principal part, the one we use for Erst Active, and we're going to need endings. So let's take elusa and make a stem out of it by taking the alpha off the end, and we're going to keep the augment because we're indicative. And now we need endings. And let's have our primary and secondary person markers for both middle and passive. And let's remember that aorist is a secondary tense, so we're going to use the secondary person markers. And we're going to add them to the characteristic alpha of the aorist. And we will get amen and o. There's that second person singular again. It should be asa with the sa ending and the characteristic alpha. But the intervocalic sigma drops out, and the alpha and omicron contract into an omega. The rest of the endings are ata, amatha, astha, and anta. Accent is recessive, and the default translation is either she verbed for herself, or she caused to be verbed, or whatever past time simple aspect translation of your particular verb makes sense. So let's conjugate. We need the principal part, stem, including the augment, and we need then all the endings, amen, o, ata, amatha, astha, and anta. We need recessive accent, which we'll put in, and we get elusamen, I caused to be freed, or I ransomed, eluso, you caused to be freed, or you ransomed, elusata, she caused to be freed, or she ransomed, elusametha, we caused to be freed, or we ransomed, elusastha, y'all caused to be freed, or y'all ransomed, and elusanta, they caused to be freed, or they ransomed. Now, for the perfect indicative middle, which is just like the perfect indicative passive, yay! Which, as you remember, is from the fifth principal part, and you add the primary middle passive person markers right there on the stem with recessive accent, and the default translation for the middle now is she has caused to be verbed, or she has verbed for herself, because we are present time and completed aspect. Finally, we have the pluperfect indicative middle, which is rarely seen, but which, again, looks exactly like the passive version of the same tense and mood. So you already know that fifth principal part with the past indicative augment, the secondary person markers, recessive accent, and for the middle, the default translation is she had verbed for herself, or she had caused to be verbed, or whatever past time completed aspect translation of your verb makes the most sense. And there you have your new middle indicative forms. You only have to learn new forms for the future in aorist middle. Even then, the future ones have the endings that you know. Your challenge now is to recognize when you're looking at a passive and when you're looking at a middle. Context should tell you. Look for the presence or absence of a direct object, and learn the specific middle meanings of your verbs. But now you know the forms you need to be able to practice and use the middle voice in six tenses of the indicative. In the next video, we'll cover the middle of the subjunctive, optative, and infinitives.